I think when we look back on COVID-19, you know, we will find that it is actually acting as a catalyst in e-learning technologies. So, you know, I know the situation is grim, you know, a lot of people, you know, are, these are challenging times, but purely from the point of, you know, how we learn and how we interact and what we do, I mean, this meeting itself is an example. We are all sitting in, probably in our homes and, you know, talking to each other with some small, you know, whatever innovative backgrounds that we have been able to come up with, right? So that you know, forces us to learn, right? So similarly, this COVID, you know, has forced us to bring in what we already had been propagating before COVID-19, which is under the heading of blended learning. Okay, so we had already, you know, in fact, you know, Santosh was here a couple of months back at Amrita, and we came up with this entire paradigm of blended learning and said how blended learning is the way to go forward, right?
Yes.
Because what is happening, even in the simplest of learning, you know, the student goes to class, he learns something, then he goes home, he either looks at some YouTube video or he looks at a lecture. And when he's looking at that YouTube video or some content on his mobile, then he's learning from that. Or he sits with his friends, you know, the girls or the boys, they sit in a group in the hostel and they study together. And then they go online somewhere and then they go to class. So when you combine all of these modalities together, what is happening is what we can call as blended learning. So blended learning really is the way to go forward.
Absolutely.
Now the real question is, you know, when you say blended learning, you are making like a, to use a Bombay word, bhelpuri, right? So, you know, how much chutney you put, how much, you know, hot chutney you put, how much sweet chutney you put, and how much of which item you put is up to, it's your curry, right? You are cooking the curry as the course creator and the teacher.
Yes.
And you have to know very well, my students are at this level. The technology of my students at this level. My teachers are at this level. My technology of my teachers is at this level.
Absolutely.
The infrastructure available is at this level. So keeping all those factors in mind, you have to make this curry of blended learning. Does this so
yes.
The main I guess what you're asking is what are the main factors in which we go forward in creating this blended learning?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you look at it at this point, it was underutilized to some, not known, I would say. We didn't know its potential. It wasn't recognized, as far as I would understand, as a college student. So how do you think it's going to be taken forward is what I was asking from right. this point.
Right. So the way, you know, it is already being taken forward. Many colleges and schools and organizations who at least had some awareness of e-learning and online learning, they have already started, you know,
online
classes and all these things, and they are very active already.
True.
And the people who have no clue, they are struggling to find, you know, where to go next. So the way I feel it's going to go forward is that, you know, we need, for the people who don't know, we need to have some standardization and some you know, basic knowledge. What, you know, if I sit and analyze and think, if I was to go online today, who would be the biggest bottleneck? The student or the teacher?
Yeah.
Right. And in this age of technology, unfortunately, usually it's the teacher who's the bottleneck.
Yes.
You know, because the kids, you know, they have grown up with mobiles and, you know, they are texting like, you know how everybody is texting and using the online apps. So they, you know, any new technology to them, whether it is this video conferencing or whether it is going to a website and doing things, they will learn very, very fast because they're already doing it. They're immersed. You know, whether it is, you know, Facebook or Skype or, you know, WhatsApp or, and, you know, there's a list of another 20 social apps that I could mention. Mm-hmm. But, you know, once you are into online technology, the students are already, you know, they are already trained.
Yes.
So we have to do serious teacher training.
Yeah, but
yes.
So adding to this one, I would love to mention here that whenever we used to call e-learning, people used to think that it is like a series of slides running in the classroom or somewhere something has been recorded and that CD has to put in the computer and run it and call it as e-learning. I myself and even Kamalji, we know that in our journey for last 10 years, how we tried to convince that this is not e-learning. The e-learning can be much, much, much higher and better, and there are many levels. And by this COVID situation, we have come to realize that the e-learning can take a different orbit shifting mode where the people can come online and interact online, see online, and even collaborate online and do projects online. So teacher training is one of the major component that also can be done even using online platform. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for giving a like.
Sure. So this, you know, and then, you know, just like you, all of you are using Zoom right now. Mm-hmm. So, you know, using Zoom, you know, we are not, I mean, we are using, you know, our Zoom or MS Teams or AVIEW or, you know, Google Meet or, you know, there are 10 platforms out there that are popular right now for video chatting, right? And it doesn't really matter, you know. The thing is, it has to work for you and you have to be comfortable with it. That's all that matters. So, you know, it was in 2009 that we met President Kalam, actually. Uh-huh. And at, you know, Sona College, he inaugurated AVIEW, actually. Mm-hmm. So, and then, you know, it went on to become part of the Ministry of HRD. Mm-hmm. And it became a huge project with IIT Bombay. And, you know, we gave AVIEW to around 12,000 colleges. So in a way, and then, you know, the our professor, you know, Deepak Fatak and Kannan Modgalia from IIT Bombay, they were kind of the pioneers in this. And, you know, Professor Deepak Fatak, you know, he was a close friend. He still is. And he used to tell me, Kamal, mujhe 1,000 bachcho ko saath mein padhana hai. So then he said, you know, I want to teach 1,000 teachers at the same time. I want to train 1,000 teachers in the same time. And that again is teacher training. So that is FTP or faculty development programs. And then, you know, we used AVIEW. He started using AVIEW to train teachers all over India. The way the model was built was he would have 200 centers and many of them even in rural India and around 50 teachers in each center. 200 centers, and those 50 teachers were not just from one organization. They were people who would come from within 5 to 20 miles from that organization. So literally entire rural India and city India teachers. So 200 into 50 is how much? It is 10,000 teachers. Yeah. Okay. So 10,000, you know, just like right now, let's say we have 8 of us or 10 of us, and I know we can have but we had groups, you know, 200 groups of 50 people sitting in one classroom. And these are teachers, just like I was talking about faculty thing. So we had 10,000 teachers. In fact, that 10,000 teacher training program became one of the major programs of the ministry. It is called T10KT, you know, training 10,000 teachers through our software. Wow. So that has been going on for 10 years. And now Professor Kannan Modgalia still uses that to go forward.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
My next question to Mr. Santosh Talghati. So, talking of the LMS and integrating it with your concept of the global classroom, how far do you think this is empowering and how do you wish to take it ahead?
Yeah, we have a dream actually to connect 1 lakh institutes of India In fact, institutes from all over the world, and that dream we are working, Kamalji is supporting that, and we have reached so many rural schools especially. And what happens when we deliver lecture, everything goes on the air. At least now we have facility of recording. Otherwise, before I used to take the videographer to shoot the lectures, but now we have all the inner built facilities. So we really need an archive and a gallery, and also to bring experts on that platform, we need LMS and KMS. And for that, Amrita University has come up with some very good solution. There are many solutions even in the market, but when Amrita does, it does something, you know, very substantial and very, you know, with the confidence mode and always in the pioneering mode. So he presented me a model, which he will explain now, because we are collaborating with you for AMPLE, for rural education and also for urban education. So we would like to know more about the AMPLE innovation and LMS.
Sure. So the you know, the intent with which we started AMPLE was to create an environment for personalized learning. Basically, you know, we wanted to create a platform, because we know, just like all teachers are not equal, all students are not equal, all environments are not equal. When we go into a global ecosystem or an open ecosystem, we need to have a system that will adapt and be customized for everybody individually. So I, you know, if it is, you know, Amy who's taking a class, or Shivam who's taking a class, or Dishti who's taking a class, then they should feel, oh, you know, this system is keeping me in mind, right? Yeah. And then you feel more of a connection and an affinity with that system. So basically, the personalized learning is one of the major, you know, things that we provide. So questions are there at multiple levels. And if the course instructor has the content is also graded. So, you know, the questions, we use Bloom's taxonomy or difficulty levels to have the assessments and questions at different levels. And then, you know, the system will automatically give you the questions that you are doing well in. And so ways to, you know, network your content so that, let's say, you know, you're not doing well in Pythagoras theorem, then automatically we take you and explain the basics of triangles, for example. So that, you know, if one concept is not being understood, or, you know, the student is not doing well, you take them to another concept, which is the underlying concept of that concept.
You mean to say it is like a tracking and also labeling the studies, sir?
Exactly. Yeah. So it can be set up in that way.
I'm so floored by Kamalji speaking. I could just go on listening to everything that he says. So valuable. Thank you so much for this opportunity. Just taking it one step further, what is happening in this domain is that they said that man saw water and the boats came, and the more water he saw, the ports came. Okay. So that's typically happening at this point in time from the evolution standpoint. Everybody thought that we are, and in a way, when we speak about ABU, Rample, these were Noah's Ark at a point in time, built for a future, knowing that it will become the city for survival. And having through this pandemic and has given an opportunity in a land like India, where eklavya learning happens, okay? Everything is dependent on faculty and content. That is where who you learn from and what you learn becomes most critical. The democratization platforms become the core of learning. And this is something coming from the our Kerala experience, as well as in Rajasthan, where we kind of connected a lot of rural Talati offices through internet and provided one computer, which led to not just transactional e-commerce stuff, but also learning. So we were enabling learnings in the local school level through the same infrastructure. And now today, if you look at government having created their own Eklavya platform also, okay, that also allows not just learning, it in fact allows for remote proctoring, which means that you really can now not only teach, you can evaluate the level of learning also using the platform. What is key and what Kamalji said just now is very, very important to understand is that, like I told, I always speak about the uniqueness of a human being. Okay, there is also different learning styles. For time immemorial, and I think this is me and Santosh were talking yesterday about Herman Ebbinghaus' 1883 research, which said that the classroom kind of teaching is completely outdated. It talks about the diminishing memory curve and you typically lose 50% of what you learn today the very next day. Now, this was said in 1883. The situation was more worse when the entire set of experiment was done in 1983 again, or 1993, I believe. And if you were to check today, given the amount of distractions or varied attractions that you have, the positive word for distraction is varied attraction, the attention span is very, very low. And also to add to this, that today's learner, okay, whether you talk about Generation Z, okay, how they are called, they are typically visual learners. A large percentage of it is visual learner.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, of course, each one being unique, you are a combination of either a visual kinesthetic learner or a visual auditory learner, but it's typically a visual learner.
Yeah.
Now, when the content goes into these kind of platform, the next thing that takes over is AI and ML.
Hmm.
Okay. Now, what is happening at AI and ML is cognitive technology that kind of learns the behavior of the learner.
Mm-hmm.
And starts producing content in a way. Very simple examples being, to an auditory learner, a simple mm-hmm. phrase like, I hope you are listening or do you hear me, gets more attention than a visual learner being said, can you see what I'm saying? Or to a kinesthetic learner, hope you can feel what I'm trying to tell you. And that gets you into the learning mode. The alpha learning mode comes from there.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Also, the second fact that is also coming in is from the meditative state of learning mm-hmm. is the infusion of music into learning,
Kappa.
Which gets you again to alpha state of learning.
Mm-hmm.
So the background musics are today being researched
yeah.
okay, mm-hmm. in a way that on a particular subject, for example, yeah. if you're learning something dramatic or
yeah.
art or say science or technology,
yeah.
a particular kind of music can intune or facilitate a particular kind of learning
mm-hmm.
as well. Now, this is where the pedagogical development is also happening and the andragogical development has to happen from a teacher's point of view.
Yeah.
Okay. Because it puts a huge pressure. And trust me, today, for example, today through Amrita Initiative, we are reaching to say X population. With
yeah.
this kind of a democratization,
mm-hmm.
imagine the amount of people who can be blessed at the same time. And I find it extremely empowering. And this is where my nation or any other nation can really kind of come forward is when I take literacy to ground root levels. I can take it to villages. I can use the entire science there. And this is what I find is happening at the moment. And this is where we are in the journey. So Ampel, ABU, Eklavya, these all in together create a new world of both the teachers and learners.
Endorsing my friend Sridhar Ayers, the Amma's great devotee here. The Amma's devotees are there with a great spirit and smile. You know, that is something I learned from Amma. Beyond all the learning techniques, the loving technique. And the love is the main resource. And in today's world, how important it is. So far as in the learning system, what I have learned and gone through the different classrooms was, it was teacher-centric. If teacher is happy, everybody is happy. If teacher is angry, he can change the classroom atmosphere in a different way altogether. And it was whole, completely dependent on teacher. And today also it is depending on teacher. But one level ahead, we have gone to the self-learning mode, like LMS is there, huge content is there, where children can go ahead and learn what they want, even that what teacher is not teaching. Because teacher have some limitations. I can understand, because every teacher is not filled with 100% knowledge. They have different expertise. At the same time, even boosting, empowering learner and also boosting and empowering content is also very important. Kamalji, one of my friend here, the Raven Satinder, who is attendee of this webinar, who is working with us, she would like to put a question. She said that it's very interesting and insightful discussion going on. And she's asking you how AI can track down students who are weaker in certain subjects and help them learn in a personalized way. How artificial intelligence can play a role and how virtual learning and augmented reality kind of, you know, making them completely taking interest in the education system. So on that, she is asking you to put some light.
Hello, Revan Satinder. So that's a very good question. You know, how AI can help different students learn and, you know, find out where their strengths and weaknesses are and guide them accordingly. So as we were speaking about Ample, and as, you know, Santosh was telling us, what a teacher can do easily in Ample is that when they come there, they can create a course very quickly by using their own content and existing content. So for example, they could go to any video in YouTube, take that link and put it into Ample, right? And then, you know, by doing that itself, you create sort of a template and you create some e-content for yourself. And then the difference is that in when you have it in Ample, you have it in a structured way. So when you create a simple course, which I have seen people now creating in Ample within 1 hour, you know, they put 5-6 videos together, a few PDFs that they have, a few questions. And in 1 or 2 hours, they have a simple course or a chapter of a course. And then they share it with their students. And let's say you have 50 students, you know, or if you're teaching online, you may have 200. It doesn't matter. Once all of your students are taking that course, they are going through the content, they are taking those assessments, you as a teacher in Ample will be continuously able to see their progress and performance, right? You're able to track that. And you're not only able to track it on as a whole, you are able to track them for every question that they answer. And every question that you created in Ample is mapped to a certain topic. So when you have 50 people answer one particular question, mm-hmm. you know that these 50 people have answered, you know, how well they have done in this particular topic. Yeah. So if you have 3 questions, you know, medium, hard, difficult, you can see the level of understanding from a teacher point of view of that topic. So that itself gives you an instant analysis of how much, you know, what is the level of understanding of students in a particular topic. So that is from the teacher point of view. Now, if you had 100 teachers or 1,000 teachers, or, you know, in India, you can have, you know, 10,000 or even 1 lakh teachers teaching the same topic. If you take all that data of, you know, 1 lakh teachers teaching into 50 students, 50 lakh answers, you know, then that becomes big data. That becomes machine learning. That you can use AI techniques on that. Why? How? Because then, you know, based on the content that you gave out a certain piece of content. It could be a video, plus animation, plus an augmented reality, plus a PDF, and you ask a few questions for students to, you know, themselves answer. But the data that you may get in a place like India can be huge, you know, depending on the level of people you have in your online classes. So that automatically gives you big data. Then, you know, you have the opportunity of applying big data, AI, and machine learning to do what you need to do. From a student point of view, basically, you know, you will also see like 10 topics. And for each topic, you know, you will see that whether you are competent, you are above competent or below competent. So everything, you know, in the competency world is measured as a skill. Just like you are, you know, driving a bike or you're driving a cycle or a car, you know, you have a competency. You're a good driver. You speak English well. You speak Hindi well. You speak Tamil well. It doesn't matter, right? So like that, Revan, what happens is that for each topic, you as a student in this platform will have an idea of your competency and the level of your competency, so that if you have reached above competency in 10 topics, but you are below competent in 2 topics, then when the exam comes, you don't have to worry about 10 out of 12 topics. You focus your attention on the 2 or 3 topics that you know you still have some work to do on. Does that give you some
idea? Yeah, pretty clear. Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah, coming to
that was a very deep dive into the model.
So Reva is from Italy, and now she's communicating with us from Italy, sir.
Very nice.
I'm surviving the coronavirus here.
Oh, okay. Which part of Italy are you?
I can give you tips. I'm in Rome.
The one who corrects our answer paper doesn't know physically or even as a human being what we are. He's just concerned about my answers. Okay. No emotions involved, and everything is based on the information today. And we are talking about the human intelligence and also artificial intelligence. Whereas the world is still dealing with information technology only, not with the human technology or not with human-oriented technology. Human emotions, human level, human scaling, human career growth, tracking, nothing is there in the education system nor in the corporate system as well. Everybody wants, in the corporate sector, they are concerned about the results and also the caliber. And here in the education system, they are concerned about our knowledge and also the answers. So beyond that, how do you visualize as a soft skill trainer of a human being, not to just check their answers, but to check their potential and improve and increase their potential? How do you visualize that technology can play a role in empowering human being?
Okay, very, very interesting question. Okay, a few years back, when I went through my certifications on neuro-linguistic programming or NLP, how we call it, I was faced with a new challenge. So when I went and spoke to my learner community, who was more into technology, the moment I said NLP, they were talking about natural language processing. Okay. So I said that it's a very, very conscious choice that I plan to step behind, saying that if you're looking at machine excellence, it has to stem from human excellence.
Yeah.
A human being at alpha state can only create alpha product. And if you have a compromised human being, you have a compromised product. So for me, and it kind of then spins into a flywheel where one starts to aid the another, okay? Because the environment, the technology is able to infuse a very inclusive structure, okay? And it is able to bring in learning from very varied scopes, whereas you'd have only focused from one source. You have multi-source environment now, both enabling the human intelligence and stepping up the machine excellence part of it. Okay. So it then falls into a kind of a cycle that enables each other. At this point in time, as we speak, in fact, let's take, I was listening to Kamalji. It's such a pleasure today. I'm like completely awed. In fact, a couple of years back when we were in, today we're talking about simple learning that is getting transfused. There was a specific brain surgery, okay? A specific kind of brain surgery being done at AIIMS Cochin, okay? By a specialist team which has flowed in for a particular thing. And there are a lot many surgeons across India who wanted to learn this. So we were the technology partners at that point in time for the company that I was representing. And we were live streaming the content, live streaming operation from the operation table to I don't know how many hotel rooms where various neurosurgeons are present watching it. Okay. Now look at also what has happened in terms of All India Spine. This thing. They also use now Eklavya kind of platforms to kind of enable certifications. So when they are able to accomplish such complex task, okay, it is only a matter of enablement and a human will to make sure that this technology gets adopted and gets democratized.
Portals. Most of the portals in today's world are dealing with information. And now, Dishti, you are talking about the students' community. And we are also, Kamalji is also talking about the teachers community. Even if you take just single Maharashtra, only in the education, 7.5 lakh primary teachers are there. And in all India, if we measure, more than 40 crore learners are there. So how we can manage this artificial intelligence and all these technologies to bring people together and make them enabled? If they want to learn, let them learn. If they want to pursue the career opportunities, how to do that? There are some model examples are there. We may have to come up with some human orientation as well using technology, though we are there in the very initial steps. Yes, Sridhar, you want to add something? And after that, Victor has...
I just wanted to take this discussion one step behind.
Yeah.
Okay. The fact that I learned it long time back that you sell the cars and the petrol will be consumed by itself. Mm. Okay. One of the critical challenges, and this is something very interesting. A large part of our learning ecosystem today, the environment that we are in, is still on a one-on-one or one-on-many on a classroom. Okay. The infrastructure today, it will become the key that how this message will spread to millions tomorrow.
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. For example, for a long time, it has been discussed that, you know, should we do away with books? One is that it saves a lot of trees, which is, I simply love the concept. But at the second space of it, I'm also worried saying that if we increase the number of laptops, what happens to the environment as well? So that's a debate for some other day. But the fact is today, laptops have become reality. I'll give you a very small example. When this pandemic started and my son is trying to get coached for an entrance exam, that school, which is typically into a classroom, were able to come online within 48 hours. Those teachers who had never taught online were able to adopt technology like there was no tomorrow. Okay. And today we see that ecosystem growing. But again, what is the challenge? A lot of the student community is today trying to learn from a mobile handset, which is a smartphone. Or if there is a system at home, there is one shared system. So the father is also working from the home. Student is also studying from the home. So the infrastructure sharing becomes a challenge. And the third, what is happening is the bandwidth consumption.
Yes.
I come from telecom, right? And you would suddenly see that there is a 100-fold or a 1,000-fold increase on the gigabyte that we started consuming today. So at a policy level decisions also now, from a government to education to kind of system, we have to start formulating and allowing our ecosystem or the environment to start to be the right kind of incubation grounds, the right kind of fertile grounds for all this data to come in, one. Number two, the artificial intelligence or the big data is all about how many people do you reach, how many varied or different inputs come into the system. And that defines the robustness of the system in itself. Okay. So the ecosystem is very, very small, but it's good enough to go ahead and start the work. Because at a point in time, one of my brothers used to work in NASA and he used to say that whatever we are using today will be used in every house 15 years from now.
Kamalji.
Okay.
Coming to Kamalji now, you know, during the concluding part of this conversation, how you compare this current situation of learning, growing, you know, empowering and using technology 10 years before, and how you can envision after 10 years this complete trend in the technology, Kamal sir, how this trend will drive us, or we will drive this emerging ways of technologies, please.
Sure. So, you know, when I, even today, when I look back 10 years, you know, we as I said, you know, we started a platform just like Zoom, and, you know, we have primarily been in the higher educational market. The main challenge we had then was that there wasn't enough bandwidth. Yeah,
even now there are many problems.
Yeah, I mean, even now there are issues, but at least, you know, from our homes we are able to do this video conference with the 7 videos running in parallel, you know.
Yeah.
And you know, if we had enough bandwidth, we can have 15-20, you know, practically speaking. But in those days, you know, we had only 1 or 2 people on video, and you know, and the rest of people had to ask questions through text or chat. So similarly, you know, looking 10 years forward, I think the biggest thing that will definitely improve is the bandwidth, you know, in a big way, you know. So we will no longer have to worry about, you know, making a call, and making a call will be like, you know, even today we are able to make this call on WhatsApp with 5, 10. So I and my students, whether it is 20, 50, 100, 200, they can all be there live, and that is more or less there today also. But it'll be even easier, right? The video conferencing will be just trivial. I mean, that is definite. The second is that it'll be much more personalized and customized. So when I, you know, I'm here with, whether I'm here with Raven, Dishti, Amy, all of you, and then immediately I will know as a teacher, when I come to the live session, what are the areas in which you are having difficulties, right? So I'm not doing to just come and talk blindly on some topics, you know, which you are not interested in. I will be only talking specifically on areas in which you have raised concerns or you have shown interest. So I will be talking about the face-to-face or the classroom thing will be more about projects, you know. You know, Raven wants to do a project, you know, on the Roman Cathedral or whatever. You know, Disti wants to do a project on something. Amy wants to do a project on something. So everybody's project, because finally the learning does not happen from by-harding a lot of stuff. The real learning happens from doing things, thinking about what you will do and then doing it, and then analyzing to see how you could have done it better.
Wow.
I think it's a change from the classic open your book, dictate, learn. It helps students learn and use their imagination and be more creative, which I think it's very important for the Indian educational system where students are, you know, running towards the scores and marks and there's a big rush.
Exactly.
I think it's a really good idea.
So, you know, it's not just about technology. The methodology and the pedagogy is much more important. Right?
Yeah.
Technology is pretty much there even today. What we need to revamp is, you know, bring project-based learning, active learning into the classroom. So when I create a classroom, and when I see a classroom of the future, which is happening today at MIT, at Harvard, at Singapore University, the students are not sitting like an army, you know, and then all watching the teacher. They are actually sitting in groups discussing with each other. In small groups of 4 and 5. So I take my class, I break them into 10 groups of 3-4 people. I give them a problem to solve and they work on that and then they report that. So that entire paradigm of whether you call it active learning, project-based learning, flipped classroom, you know, they all boil down to the same thing, which is, you know, the students need to do project-based learning to really get into things. And what I sit and give the lecture, that they can watch at home.
Yeah.
You know, if I need to watch a 5-minute talk on how to make a cake, you know, I will study the recipe. Every learning or teaching is basically some sort of recipe that we by heart. Fine, that recipe is needed. But I, as a teacher, am wasting my time and the student's time if I am just repeating that recipe for 20 years like a parrot. Right? So when I am here, you know, and then Amy should say, I want to make strawberry cake. And Disti will say, I want to make chocolate cake. And Raven will say, you know, I want to make an Italian cake. So that is where things get interesting because they want to do something. And I, as the teacher or the expert, help them do what they want to do and then they do it. So what I see, Mr. Santosh, is a paradigm shift from this rote-based learning or by-harding, you know, and sort of vomiting or, you know, in the exam and then forgetting about it, which doesn't help anybody and actually is a terrible waste of human potential and time.
Yeah, really.
So that methodology has to be changed. And I believe this technology will enable us to do it.
At the same time, yes, sir, absolutely right. The way in the simple version, in the human language, you have put it without using any big words that human cannot perceive. A very systematical way you have put the current education system and the solution through technology. At the same time, how we are empowering, because I used to use just 600 rupees one handset few years before, and now I have come to iPhone. And tomorrow, if something new will come, Dr. Sridhar will talk on this one. So we are changing our mobiles because we want the latest mobiles and latest technologies. But when I compare with myself, can I expect latest Santosh from myself, or do I expect the same 10 years old or 20 years old mentality Santosh? Even my attitude and my mentality and my inner skills and my empowering skills towards me as a human being also need to change. Then only I can say that you know, I can use the iPhone 10 or iPhone 11 XR or any model. At the same time, I should be able to tell that I am latest now. I am not the same version of Santosh Talagatti 1 year back, 10 years back. So what do you think as a soft skill trainer while concluding this session, sir? Sridharji.
One thing that you said is that technology, today you're talking about you being able to talk to one mobile. Hmm. Okay. The other thing that is happening on the side is IoT, Internet of Things. Okay. Tomorrow, almost everything around you is going to speak to you. Okay. The cars have started speaking to you already.
Yeah.
The fridges have started speaking to you already. The TVs already speak to you.
Yeah.
And possibly tomorrow, even the, if God willing, the trees talk today. Mm. And possibly every single thing will start speaking to you tomorrow.
Yeah.
To be relevant, okay, adoption and being future fit will become key.
Yeah.
Okay. So to evolve or to become extinct will be a choice that always remains as it is today. Okay. So as evolution 2.0, 3.0, 4.0 kicks in, things of relevance will also keep.
I think we have lost Sridhar's voice.
Continue to reap benefits.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is one part of it. Also, what you're seeing is that even today, when we started out, we have kind of gone back to the baby boomers of yesteryears who have become extremely good at technology today. Okay. We're talking about my parents and grandparents and how evolved they are. They're doing e-banking and stuff. And this continues. So as the forefront seems more fortified adopting new technology, the remaining population also becomes compelled to get used to or get fit into the environment that is getting created, leads to overall evolution. Okay. Also, what you can't forget is that these are all hardware stuff, and then there are software stuff, and there are software elements to it. Okay. All put together will create the environment which is conducive for the teachers of tomorrow and the learners of tomorrow across all age groups, across all segments.
Revan, would you like to add something before we conclude?
Not really.
Yes, Emmy, please take to the concluding, question or remarks.
Yeah. So on after having heard everything, as we conclude, in the first place, I feel elated that everybody could take some time out from their schedule for this today. Thank you so much for that. And on a conclusive note, I would like to ask Professor Vishnani that having spoken of all this, where do you see India picking up as compared to the world in the next 5-10 years, talking of e-learning?
So, when you compare India with the rest of the world, in some ways, we tend to, copy the West. I mean, of course, the best institutes, colleges, the top 100 institutes are in the West. So it is in some way natural that we need to learn from the West. But increasingly, it's not just about India and, the rest of the world. The whole world in this, as you can see in the video conference, is becoming a global place.
Yeah.
We have Revan, she's here from Italy, somebody could have been here from you. Increasingly, it's becoming a global place. But we, as India, we have extraordinarily strong roots. Okay. And, that again goes back to the earlier topic that I raised about emotional intelligence.
Yeah.
And, whether you call that love or that feeling or that social bonding or that caring for each other,
values,
whatever words you put onto that,
yeah,
that actually, separates us from the rest in a big way. So that feeling of love, caring, social, emotional intelligence is something that we possess strongly and we should not lose it. We should keep our roots and yet learn from the best of the West.
Thank you so much, sir. as we come to the end of this session, I would, before we wind off, does anybody have anything to add or say here? So,
thank you so much
again for taking time out, and I think we can call it today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kamalji and Sridhar sir. You know, really, I find it as Amma's blessings that Amma brought us together. And as you rightly said, that this is love which leads, you know, good emotions and binding, because the way we have connected, this is not only money which connects us, because in the modern world, in the professional world, we think that only professional aspects and money which connects. But today, the Kamalji's lecture, the speech, though it is emerging trends of technology, he said that emerging trends of love, that how it connects human beings beyond technology and beyond all the risks.